Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Just 3 days ago, I was proud to sign the Protect Illinois Communities Act banning the sale and distribution of assault weapons, high-capacity magazines, and rapid-fire switches. And here we are, once again, celebrating the signing of another piece of nation-leading legislation. Last summer, when Roe v. Wade was overturned, I promised you that Illinois would take action to protect our people, to remain a beacon of hope, an island of reproductive justice. Since that day, we've seen out-of-state patients who've been denied their rights in other states coming to Illinois for abortion care. Our clinics have been doing their best to serve the people seeking to exercise their rights, but they've been overwhelmed. The U.S. Supreme Court has forced women, especially those most marginalized, to flee their home states in search of safe health care. Here in Illinois, we know we have an obligation to support and protect reproductive freedom for our residents and those who seek safe haven. And we must protect our doctors and nurses, too. The right to reproductive health care has been the law of the land in Illinois and across the nation, really, for 50 years. But pro-choice advocates and elected officials knew that the right wing would try to overturn Roe. So here in Illinois, we worked together to protect reproductive rights, and we succeeded when we signed the Reproductive Health Act in 2019. Last year, the Supreme Court's Dobbs decision created new challenges. So we went back to work, and the General Assembly passed House Bill 4664, a monumental new law that further protects patients and providers who seek and deliver legal and safe reproductive health care in Illinois. To care for our own residents and also meet the needs of patients coming from other states, we are expanding our pool of providers and eliminating barriers to access by allowing birth centers to provide all reproductive care, eliminating copays for reproductive health care medication like birth control, abortive medications, and gender-affirming therapies, all while expanding provider capacity by allowing qualified practice registered nurses or physician assistants to perform aspiration abortions, just like 20 other states do. Here in Illinois, we know that reproductive care is health care. A medical decision should be made between a patient and their health care provider, no one else. Every single person, regardless of gender, sexuality, race, and economic status, has the right to privacy and bodily autonomy. And when people come to Illinois to exercise those rights, they will be welcomed and protected. That's what this historic bill stands for. And I couldn't be more thankful for the hard work of Senator Selena Villanueva and Representative Kelly Cassidy, who worked around the clock with advocates and stakeholders and the public to get it right. We are only here making this the law of the land because of the steadfast advocacy of hundreds of thousands of Illinoisans, along with stakeholder partners. There are too many organizations to name, but some of them are here with us today, and they deserve a shout out. Thank you to the ACLU, to Brave Space Alliance, to the Abortion Fund, Chicago Abortion Fund, Equality Illinois, Lambda Legal, the Midwest Action Project, Personal PAC, and Planned Parenthood. And I'm sure I have left some out, but I want them all to know how important their advocacy has been in making this a reality. These groups, along with patients and providers across the state, made it clear that they expected us as public servants to ensure that we would enact the strongest possible protections. I ask you all to take a moment to reflect upon the war that is being waged on women's bodies by the zealots on the right, and how brave and unafraid all of you have been. You have proven that here in Illinois, we will never back down in the battle to protect reproductive justice. With that, it is my sincere pleasure to turn it over to one of the fiercest advocates I know, Senator Selena Villanueva.
Good morning, everyone. I want to start off with a million and one thank yous to the advocates, a bunch of who are standing with us today, who are out in the crowd and who probably are out doing their jobs right now, unable to be here. We thank you all, because coming from that space, that's where my heart resides. I want to thank the governor, the lieutenant governor. I want to thank my sister in so many different fights, Kelly Cassidy, Representative Cassidy, for holding firm, giving me a couple more gray hairs, but also, you know, being able to be in this fight together. And I also want to thank Senate President Don Harmon, who was in with us here today, and hopefully he has some time to be able to grieve his mother, finally, after a very long lame duck and then inauguration week, to be able to take the time to actually spend time with his family. I thank him for his leadership and his support throughout all of this. And there's so many people to thank, but I want to get into my remarks. This legislation consolidates Illinois as an island that protects reproductive and gender-affirming rights in the Midwest and places our state at the forefront of a nation for granting people the freedom to make their life decisions. House Bill 4664 protects reproductive health care patients and providers from out-of-state legal action and widens access to reproductive care. It also protects the licenses of healthcare professionals who provide care that is illegal in other states and prevents insurers from charging more for out-of-network care when in-state providers object to treatment on moral grounds. These protections are needed, and I say this personally, as a Latina, in my opinion, from my experience, because half of Latinas of childbearing age in the United States live more in the states that restrict women's reproductive rights. We're trying to protect patients, we're trying to protect providers, and we're trying to protect families with this bill. I want to take it a little personal because I take this fight very, very personally. While other countries like Mexico are legalizing abortion, there are states in this country that are creating refugees, coming to Illinois to seek refuge, to make bodily decisions of their own, to be able to take care and access health care that helps them. This is no different than some of the other needs that we have as people that are legal in other states right now. But this is a persecution of people trying to live their lives and make decisions for themselves. Being an immigrant rights organizer, being a daughter of immigrants who were undocumented when they came to this country and who were undocumented when they had me in 1985, who were legalized in 1986 because of the Immigration Reform and Control Act. One of the reasons why I'm so steadfast on this is because one of the major things that nobody wants to talk about in this fight is the reason why. And that is because there are too many babies being born to women who look like me in this country, being born to undocumented families coming to this country. If you don't think that immigration and trans rights and every other fight is intrinsically tied to reproductive rights, you are wrong. They are all tied together. It's because of women who look like me, who are younger than me, who are having too many babies, and white women who are not having enough babies. It is because of the fear of people like me being in positions like me to be able to fight for our trans family members in these positions and say their rights matter, their right to live matter. That's what these fights are about. It is about fighting not just prosecution, but persecution. It is about fighting oppression and suppression. And it's a fight that I'm going to continue for the rest of my life. Thank you. Let me introduce the woman who likes to give me gray hairs, and we're going to have pink hair eventually together.
I was going to offer you something.
Yeah. But my sister, in so many fights, we did cannabis together, we've done this together, and we'll probably do a hell of a lot more together. My sister, Representative Kelly Cassidy.
Good morning. When the Supreme Court overturned Roe, I learned an important lesson. Doesn't matter how long you've anticipated a punch in the gut, it still hurts. We all came together on that day, too. Many of us were together. And as we hugged and cried and consoled each other, I thought about the people who dedicate their time and energy to attacking those least able to defend themselves. Whether that's enacting bans on reproductive care, attacking the trans community by taking away health care, or simply trying to legislate them out of existence. And I resolved to punch those bullies back even harder. I referred to them as bullies in debate on the House floor. They didn't like it, but that's exactly what they are. They're punching down. Well, they got a problem. Folks, this is the first of those punches, but certainly not the last. Soon after the decision, Speaker Welch announced the formation of working groups, including the Reproductive Rights and Dobbs Decision Working Group. Mr. Speaker, thank you for entrusting this work to such a dedicated and focused group of worker bees. These legislators showed up all summer long as we heard from dozens of stakeholders, including folks on the receiving end of those daily punches in other states. And to my oldest son, Josh, who's here today, this is where I start to lose it. He wouldn't be here but for access to the full spectrum of reproductive health care. Thank you for tolerating all of the weekend meetings, the vacation meetings, the endless talk about this topic at the dinner table. I love you and your brothers so very much. Thank you to the members of the Dobbs Working Group, former leaders Greg Harris and Latoya Greenwood, representatives Dagmara Avalar, Lakeisha Collins, Tara Costa Howard, Margaret Croak, Anna Moeller, and Ann Williams, some of whom couldn't be here today. And thank you to our fierce ally, my sister, Senator Villanueva. I love you to the end of the earth. Gray hairs and all. We had amazing staff supporting us all along the way, and the captains of that ship were my incredible chief of staff, Torrance Gardner, and Kendra Piercy from the speaker's staff, with an able assist from Taylor Howard and Kevin DePasqua. Complex bills like this that go through seemingly endless rounds of revisions well into the night won't happen without the often unnoticed heroes of the Legislative Reference Bureau, and I sure hope Lauren Smith is getting some well-earned rest after what we put her through. And I would be remiss if I didn't shout out the folks who joined us to lend their expertise all summer long, from Governor Pritzker's staff and Attorney General Raul's brilliant team. And finally, the real heroes are the folks who are showing up every day and finding a way to help meet the ever-increasing demand for services and help, usually while simultaneously facing attacks from protesters seeking to interfere with patients accessing care. And I'm going to edit the list to try to make sure we don't repeat people. So in addition to the Planned Parenthoods, the independent abortion providers we met with, Dr. Rob Garofalo and the team at Lurie Children's, the practical support groups that are here today, and others who are facilitating connecting out-of-state patients with resources and care. And we owe a debt of gratitude to the advocates like the ACLU of Illinois, Lambda Legal, Brave Space, Equality Illinois, the AIDS Foundation of Chicago, Howard Brown Health, the Illinois State Medical Society, the Nurses Association, so many others who brought their expertise to bear to work out complex solutions to unprecedented challenges. And this is the first step of what I fear will be a long journey. As legislatures reconvene across the country, we will have to respond to the new ways that bully states will come up with to attack patients and providers. We have to continue to build our capacity to meet the demands for care in both the reproductive and gender-affirming care spaces. We have to continue to seek solutions to protect the privacy of patients and providers through examining our data privacy and retention laws. This is the fight of my life. I was born across state lines because my mother was denied the care she needed by the Catholic hospital in New Jersey, where my six siblings were born, because they wouldn't give her the hysterectomy her doctor recommended due to the complications from her late-in-life pregnancy. So I was born in Philadelphia. Our mission is clear. If you want to come after people seeking care or their providers, if your mission is to torment trans kids and their families, you're going to have to get through all of us first. Yeah. Yeah. And now I want to bring up one of the fiercest fighters. Attorney General Kwame Raoul.
Thank you. Governor Pritzker, thank you for bringing us together. Thank you for your leadership. You're off to a great start on the second term. Setting the bar high for the next 3 years and 361 days. Speaker Welch and to Senator Senate President Harmon, who not here, your capacity to manage caucuses to achieve what you've achieved over the last week is something that is underappreciated. Thank you. Representative Cassidy and Senator Villanueva, when you said you did cannabis together, I wasn't invited to the party. But thank you for the countless of hours you spent over the course of the last several months. And thank you for including our staff and allowing us to lend our expertise. I want to recognize Caitlin McKellis and Karen Bass-Ehler, who really did hard work on this. Since the Dobbs decision, states around the country began severely restricting access to abortion and, in some cases, criminalizing it. This has led to a dramatic increase in the numbers of out-of-state patients seeking reproductive care here in Illinois. This bill allows us to be equipped to respond to the need for care by expanding our provider base. While Illinois providers and support networks have stepped up, anti-choice states seek to expand the reach of their retrogressive policies beyond their own borders. They want to ignore our sovereignty and pass laws that allow them to reach into Illinois and instill fear, curb access to abortion, and punish patients and providers. As a result, out-of-state patients who seek care in Illinois and their providers fear legal repercussions when they return home. We also know that these states won't stop at abortion. Access to essential health care like contraceptives, HIV treatment, and gender-affirming care are also at stake. These are attacks on a very personal and private health care decision. No health care provider should fear losing their license or providing safe and legal medical services. And no person should fear that their private health care information will be weaponized against them. Providers, patients, and their support networks deserve the safety and protections that this law will provide. Today, we send the strong message that here in Illinois, we will use every legal tool we have to defend bodily autonomy. At this point, I want to bring a good friend, Kadeem Bennett.
Hi, everyone. My name is Kadeem Bennett. I'm the Director of Advocacy and Intergovernmental Affairs with the ACLU of Illinois. And I'm really proud to stand here with Governor Pritzker and these other champions of essential health care in Illinois. 6 months ago, the United States Supreme Court ruthlessly stripped away the recognized right to abortion, overruling Roe versus Wade and inviting states to criminalize reproductive and gender-affirming health care. Since that dark day, nearly half the states in this country have banned or tried to ban abortion. In this atmosphere, similar attacks are aimed at banning or limiting gender-affirming care in states across the country. We know that despite claims of wanting to return these issues to states, the people behind these attacks will not just stop at outlawing this care in their own states. They want to prevent people from traveling to other states for lawful health care and punish the professionals in Illinois who provide this care. Lawmakers, advocates, and residents in Illinois have worked hard to ensure that in this state, people can make their own healthcare decisions. In 2017, we passed House Bill 40 to ensure that the fall of Roe would not trigger old abortion restrictions in the state. In 2019, we passed the Reproductive Health Act to firmly establish reproductive health care as a fundamental right. And House Bill 4644 adds another layer to the wall around Illinois, protecting those who receive and provide reproductive and gender-affirming health care in the state. The legislation sends a clear message. We will not let states that are trying to restrict health care reach into Illinois and tell us what we can do in our state. And as Rep. Cassidy said, this fight will continue, and we're prepared for that fight. We want to thank you, Governor Pritzker, Attorney General Raul, Senator Harmon, Speaker Welch, Senator Villanueva, Representative Cassidy, and all of the members of the Reproductive Health Care and Dobbs Working Group for your leadership on this act. And we also want to thank you all, especially the governor, the Senate president, and the speaker for taking the time over the last several months to hear from people directly impacted by the fallout from the Dobbs decision, to understand that the current landscape in Illinois, and to craft a law that could protect to the greatest extent possible and be effective as soon as possible. And also the Dobbs Working Group, there are lots of calls for a special session, and appreciating the time it took to really craft law that would work for as many people as possible. So thank you very much, and I'm going to introduce Moni next.
Hello, everybody. My name is Moni Ruiz Velasco. My pronouns are she, her, ella, and I'm proud to be the Deputy Director of Equality Illinois, the state's oldest LGBTQ civil rights organization. As a queer Latina, as a mother, and my daughter Emma is here with me today, and as a member of the LGBTQ community, I'm honored and thrilled to be here among champions for reproductive justice, gender justice, and LGBTQ justice. I want to thank Governor Pritzker for his commitment to our communities and to ensuring that Illinois continues to be a beacon of hope for those of us who are targeted by hate because of who we are, because we choose to live our lives authentically, because of who we love, or because we exercise fundamental reproductive rights. We also would not be here today without the fierceness of my friend, Senator Selena Villanueva, as well as the unstoppable Representative Cassidy, and the leadership of President Harmon and Speaker Welch and their amazing teams. I am in awe of our partners on the ground, the amazing advocates who keep it real and bring the voices of those directly impacted to the table. It is because of all of our collective efforts that these critical protections are enacted today for providers, patients, and families who are coming to Illinois seeking reproductive and gender-affirming health care from anti-equality and anti-choice states. As a native Texan, as a woman, as a queer daughter of immigrants, as a leader in my community, I can tell you that attacks are coming in real time and from every direction. It's frightening to see the regression of our rights in this country, and it is deeply painful that at her age, at Emma's age, I had more rights than she does today in this country, but not here in Illinois. I am thankful to be in Illinois, where we are working together to pull and move this country in the right direction of expanding rights for our communities and fiercely protecting the rights we and our predecessors have won over the decades of fighting. Reproductive rights are LGBTQ rights, and these rights are inextricably linked by substantive due process claims to right to privacy, bodily autonomy, and the liberty to form one's own family. With LGBTQ communities across the country under attack, and particularly against trans youth, this essential legislation will save lives by ensuring meaningful access to gender-affirming and reproductive health care, and by providing important protections to patients, families, and providers. Illinois is a beacon of hope and a refuge for those seeking protections. I am proud to have been part of this formidable team made up of advocates, legislators, and of course the governor, who give us hope for a better today and tomorrow. Thank you, y gracias a todas las personas presentes por su liderazgo y su apoyo hacia nuestras comunidades LGBTQ, por asegurar la protección de obtener cuidados de salud necesarios para la afirmación de género, y por la protección de nuestros derechos reproductivos, incluyendo el acceso al aborto. Muchas gracias. Thank you. And I want to introduce Jennifer Welch.
Sneaking in behind you. Hi, I'm Jennifer Welch. I'm the president and CEO of Planned Parenthood Illinois Action, and my pronouns are she, her. I'm honored to stand with all of these leaders that you've heard from already today, and I'm not going to repeat their amazing words. These champions of reproductive and LGBTQ rights are thrilled that Illinois now offers strong protections for patients and providers for reproductive health care and gender-affirming care. Representative Cassidy, Senator Villanueva, and pro-choice champions in the Illinois General Assembly worked tirelessly to pass this legislation, protecting the healthcare refugees that my colleagues referred to, who are forced to flee their home states in order to receive abortion and gender-affirming care. Last year, when the Supreme Court took away our freedoms when they overturned Roe, Illinois immediately felt the impact as state after state moved to ban or severely restrict abortion access. Sometimes it looks like a race to the bottom in our neighbor states. And those same states are hostile to the LGBT community, restricting access to gender-affirming health care, equality, marriage equality, and many other rights. My colleagues have already described how this new law provides much-needed protections for patients and providers, so I will end by thanking Governor Pritzker for signing this bill and furthering Illinois as an oasis for care and for keeping us a leader in the fight for bodily autonomy, because all people should have the freedom to make medical decisions that are best for their lives, themselves, and their families. I get to introduce Megan Yahifo, the director of the Chicago Abortion Pact. Megan.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you all. I don't want to cry.
That's all right.
It's really a great day to be in Illinois. It's a great day to celebrate a win. It feels like a long time coming. I'm here representing the Chicago Abortion Fund, Illinois' statewide abortion fund that supports people across the Midwest, whether traveling to Illinois or staying in their own state. We provide individualized case management to our callers, working alongside them from start to finish, every step of the way, no matter the barrier, the cost, or circumstance. In 2022, we heard from over 7,000 people and attempted to support every single one. Almost 70% of the out-of-state Chicago Abortion Fund callers we heard from this year were coming to clinics here in Illinois for care. They came from 40 different states and two different countries. Illinois has long been a regional access point due to many of the actions described here prior to this really difficult year. And Illinoisians know that it's our responsibility to care for people who are unable to access essential, common, life-saving, and life-affirming health care in their own communities. The people of Illinois know this inherently. That's why we've supported the lawmakers and leaders behind us, behind me today. We're a little over 2 weeks out from the 50th anniversary of Roe versus Wade. And in Illinois, we've known for a long time that Roe was never enough, that it left people out, that it did not guarantee access to an abortion, and that our families and communities need so much more. In Illinois, abortion is not just a legal right, it's healthcare that's covered by Medicaid because of the actions of organizers, activists, and lawmakers. It's protected by our state constitution, and today it's healthcare that Illinois continues to resource and expand. It's not political. With the passage of the Patient and Provider Protection Act, Illinois once again leads the charge to destigmatize and protect the right to basic reproductive health care and to care for people who need to access that care, no matter who they are or where they're from. Abortion care, gender-affirming care, assisted reproduction, contraceptive access, PEP and PrEP access, all health care that should be destigmatized, decriminalized, and accessible to all. That is the commitment this piece of legislation is making to our most vulnerable communities, not just with words, but through tangible actions. Thank you again to all of the bill sponsors, to the governor's office, to Senator Villanueva and Representative Cassidy. We watched you all as a team speak, and we're just cheering you on. Thank you so much to everyone that made sure the voices of people most impacted by this were represented in crafting this legislation. We know the fight's not over, but so grateful to be in Illinois today. Thank you. I get to introduce Kara Engelhardt.
Good afternoon. afternoon. My name is Kara Engelhart. My pronouns are she and her. I'm an attorney here at Lambda Legal in Chicago. Transgender people, especially young trans and non-binary people, and their healthcare providers and their parents are under assault across the country. In Texas, we at Lambda are in court fighting a governor and an attorney general who have weaponized state child welfare agencies to investigate families and healthcare providers for child abuse, simply for providing medically necessary gender-affirming care to adolescents. And other states like Arkansas and Alabama have criminalized medical providers and parents for providing care too. And right now, people who need reproductive health care, including abortion, are facing attacks across the country. These ugly and hateful laws have threatened to reach across state borders and impact Illinois families and health care providers. But as a result of the leadership of Governor Pritzker, Speaker Welch, Senate President Harmon, Rep. Cassidy, Senator Villanueva, and the work of countless advocates and allies, including the House Dobbs Decision Working Group, Illinois, through this legislation, now provides a safe haven for families and health care providers. We at Lambda Legal are immensely grateful for the incredible work that went into this law and to the elected officials and advocates who recognized the intrinsic and inseparable link between reproductive freedom and LGBTQ plus rights. Neither can be adequately defended or progressed without the other. This legislation should serve as an example to other states on how we work together to provide and protect our freedoms and enact robust protections for trans people and abortion rights. We'll continue the fight in courts across the country to protect trans youth and to obtain access to abortion. But patients and providers here in Illinois will now enjoy protection from out-of-state attacks on our health care. We thank you. I'd like to introduce Director of Strategic Partnerships at Howard Brown, Shannon Lynn Parker.
Right, good afternoon, everybody. So I am Shannon Lynn Parker. I am so proud to be the Director of Strategic Partnerships and Affairs for Howard Brown Health. I'm also proud to be the Board President of Brave Space Alliance, as well as a proud board member of Equality Illinois. So I, just like a lot of you here today, stand appreciative to the state legislature and Governor Pritzker for sending a reverberating message that Illinois is a safe haven, allowing all people to safely and legally access necessary and life-saving reproductive health care and gender-affirming care that they can no longer access in their home states. In the wake of the devastating Supreme Court decision, more and more states have taken action to ban abortion and restrict access to comprehensive reproductive health care. Additionally, threats to undermine and restrict access to gender-affirming care are on the rise in multiple states. House Bill 4664 enshrines reproductive care is health care. Gender-affirming care is health care. And above all, health care is a human right. The bill also protects medical providers from out-of-state legal action to prosecute them for providing reproductive or gender-affirming care. Across the state of Illinois and beyond, nearly 30,000 patients a year seek Howard Brown Health for essential, quality, individualized affirming care, which includes access to reproductive and LGBTQ plus health care. It is essential to patient care that our healthcare providers are able to provide life-saving treatment without the threat of punishment, harassment, and retribution. Members of the legislature and Governor Pritzker, we thank you for enacting this law to protect patients, medical providers, and people across our country. Thank you all so much, and I'd like to introduce Speaker Welch.
Thank you, Shannon. Good afternoon, everyone. You know, my name is Emmanuel Chris Welch, Speaker of the Illinois House and brother in the struggle of Jennifer Welch. You know, I always tease her that she's my cousin. You know, it's truly an honor and a privilege to be here with my friend and partner in the fight, Governor J.B. Pritzker and Lieutenant Governor Juliana Stratton, and all these warriors standing here with us today. You know, about 6 months ago, I stood here alongside them, many of these same colleagues, and together we mourned a dark day in our nation's history. It was a day here in Illinois that we had prepared for, but we certainly hoped it would never come. It was in a day that the extremist Supreme Court decided that half of Americans didn't have bodily autonomy, and they didn't get to make deeply personal medical decisions without government interference, without a politician telling them what to do with their own bodies. But it was also on that day that I stood here with Governor Pritzker, Senate President Don Harmon, Representative Kelly Cassidy, Representative Croak, and Representative Collins, and Representative Avalar, and so many of my colleagues in the General Assembly who have been champions in this space for a very long time. And we promised that in Illinois, we would not go back. We made that our mantra. We said we won't go back, and we will not go back. Because, as I said just 2 days ago at our inauguration of the General Assembly, in Illinois, we trust women. Today, tomorrow, and every day, we trust women. We know that when we take away a person's ability to choose, we are taking away their rights to equality, dignity, and respect for privacy. I'm proud to stand here alongside these champions who've made it their mission to protect patients and providers. But I gotta tell you, I'm especially thankful for our resident badass in the House, Representative Kelly Cassidy. She is truly, one of the fiercest advocates I've ever known. And I will tell you, putting her together with the rest of our House Dobbs Decision Working Group, we were unstoppable, and I knew we were gonna get the job done. Thank you, Representative Cassidy. They've spent months negotiating and meeting with stakeholders to ensure we had sound policy that made Illinois a safe haven in the Midwest. And that's exactly what we are. But if I'm being honest, if I'm being really honest, today is a little bittersweet, because we stand here celebrating our progress here in Illinois. We know that there are so many people who are ready to take away these rights in other places. Just look what's happening in Washington, D.C. this week alone. Look at what's happening with that Republican-controlled House and 20 extremists in charge of our House of Representatives. We know that they want to take away these rights at any given moment. And since that tragic day in June of 2022, 14 states have already completely banned abortion care, and many others have passed laws severely restricting it. In 2023, people are being forced to travel thousands of miles to receive medical care. Miscarriages and ectopic pregnancies have been turned into life-threatening experiences, and young girls are being forced to bear children of their abusers. That's just wrong. It's not just heartbreaking. It's unacceptable, it's wrong, and it's inhuman. But that's why the fight continues, here in Illinois and across this country. We know our Supreme Court has laid out a blueprint for rights they plan to take away next. But we'll be ready here in Illinois. Mm-hmm. You can count on that. I know that to be true because of the people right here who surround me, because of the people sitting out here in the audience, like Terry Cosgrove and Personal Pack, like my Deputy General Counsel who's will work all day, all night, Kendra Piercy. There's so many people involved in this fight to make sure these rights stay protected. We will work together to fight for human dignity and equality for all people. In Illinois, we will never go back. Congratulations to everyone who had a hand in this policy and thank you for your persistence and dedication to get this right. At this time, I am truly honored to introduce to you my friend, my former colleague in the House, a true champion and governor partner, our dynamic Lieutenant Governor. Please welcome a champion for equity and justice, Lieutenant Governor Juliana Stratton.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm Lieutenant Governor Juliana Stratton, and I use she, her pronouns. Thank you, Speaker Welch, for that warm introduction and for your leadership for the people of Illinois. And thank you, Governor Pritzker, for your steadfast commitment to acting decisively when Illinoisans' health and well-being is under threat. In the interest of time, I also want to thank everyone who stands with us in this fight for reproductive rights, including members of the General Assembly, who ensured Illinois remains an oasis with the passage of this act, especially the bill's sponsors, Representative Kelly Cassidy and Senator Selena Villanueva. And Senator, I just want to take a moment to just pause and thank you especially for being such a powerful voice and representative of women of color in this fight. Thank you to all of you, as well as Attorney General Kwame Raoul and all the providers and advocates joining us on the front lines, protecting access to reproductive care for all. Your tireless efforts for people in Illinois and for people seeking care in our state, because we are often the only place they can turn to, your roles, big and small, are so important right now. We are committed to being there with you, to continuing to take decisive action that makes it clear Illinois is a safe haven for all. That's why we're here today. The Patient and Provider Protection Act is about self-determination, for people to be in control of their own health care, for health care professionals to be able to do their jobs and not be punished for it. The attacks on access to abortion, the fear-mongering and barriers to critical health care for LGBTQ plus individuals, this is a concerted effort to strip people of their bodily autonomy, to take away the right to make decisions about our bodies and well-being, and we are not going to stand for it. Most urgent of all, this is about trying to force our most vulnerable to suffer in silence. In fact, in so many ways, it's clear that it's the cruelty that's the point. But in Illinois, we listen to you. We proudly stand with you so your voices are heard, so your needs are met, and we will fight for and with you. We welcome you with open arms, and we put our foot down when others attempt to criminalize providers who answer the call to deliver care, or patients who decide what is best for them, their lives, and their futures. In Illinois, while others try to turn back the clock on progress, we recognize that our way forward is together, in lockstep with our LGBTQ plus community, with women and girls from all backgrounds, from rural and urban regions, and with our neighbors in other states who are experiencing the consequences of laws and policies that take away their fundamental rights. As we all prepare to celebrate Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday this weekend, and everyone, including those who do not support this bill, will post their quote, their favorite Dr. King quote, I want to close with a quote from his life partner, Coretta Scott King, a civil rights warrior in her own right. She said these words, freedom and justice cannot be parceled out in pieces to suit political convenience. I don't believe you can stand for freedom for one group of people and deny it to others. In Illinois, today we recommit to reproductive freedom and justice for all. Thank you. And with that, I am thrilled to invite the governor to come forward and sign the Patient and Provider Protection Act into law.
Initials. I've seen him do it with twice.
Yeah.
Underappreciated.
That's really fun.
Thank you.
Happy to take any questions from members of the media. Yes, sir.
Move on to one of your other legislative triumphs this year, the assault weapons ban. You're facing some pushback from sheriffs around the state, a dozen or more, that said they will not enforce the bill. Perhaps you and perhaps the Attorney General can comment on what can be done to protect the assault weapons ban and how you intend to address those sheriffs.
Well, let's be clear. They took an oath of office to enforce the laws of the state of Illinois, and they will do so. At this point, as you know, people need to register their existing weapons. We've outlawed the purchase, the sale of these assault weapons, and it's up to individuals who own weapons today to come forward. They have to file a paper with the state police, as you know. That's not something that requires the intervention of a sheriff, for example. And I think that they're doing it as a matter of political grandstanding. They hope to delay long enough to have this run through the court system. I'm confident that this is a constitutional law that we've signed into existence, and they'll find that out once it's gone through the process. But again, these are folks who are entrusted by the public to enforce the law. They don't get to choose which laws they enforce. They must enforce what we've written into the code, the General Assembly signed by the governor, and they will do so. Happy to have the Attorney General if you have another comment on that.
Well, first of all, ditto. I, as Attorney General, I get to weigh into my legislators as to what our opinion is on pending legislation. Sheriffs have a sheriff's association. They have an opportunity to do the same. But once the legislature passes a legislation and the governor attaches his signature to it, it's the law of the land that they have the duty that they've sworn an oath to enforce. I will say also that as law enforcement agencies, there's overlapping jurisdiction as well. So if they don't do their jobs, there are other people available to do the job.
I have one more.
Yes, sir.
We've heard that you might be going to Davos for the conference there. If so, what do you plan to do to help the people of Illinois?
Well, I want to promote the state of Illinois. I was very pleased and honored to be invited to go to the World Economic Forum, just as I did last year, as you know, to COP26 to promote our Climate and Equitable Jobs Act. While I'm in Davos, I'll be meeting with national leaders here from the United States, but also international leaders, and promoting commerce for the state of Illinois, as well as the ideas that have really come forth from the state of Illinois that I think others may want to follow.
The conference made up of world leaders. You one day hope to be on that stage as perhaps.
We're the fifth largest state in the United States. We're already on the world stage.
Good answer, good answer.
All right, thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That was the best answer.
A couple of questions at the end. They're being asked from a reporter in the room, having nothing to do with the purpose of today's event. But just to recap those questions, one asked about the assault weapons ban that was just enacted recently by the governor, another bill signed. In fact, if you're on our website or going to click on that link I put in the video description, if you're Facebook or YouTube, that's one of the stories that I added in there as an option to continue reading for those that missed that bit of news, that Illinois has instituted a ban on assault-style weapons immediately, the sale and purchase thereof, and then for anybody that currently owns one, they have approximately 1 year to register that weapon. He was asked about a number of sheriffs, so that is county-level law enforcement officer, constitutional officer, stating that they're going to refuse to enact, that's not even the right word, follow that law. And as stated by the governor and the attorney general, the opinions there are that they were elected to do what the law says, as opposed to choosing what laws they will and will not enforce. That's the word I was looking for, enforce. But also that law doesn't really have too much at this point to do with county level law enforcement. So a lot to come yet on that as those opinions come in, and there are lawsuits, I'm sure, being worked on right now that will be filed soon enough as it relates to that law. Another question then asked about Governor Pritzker attending a worldwide conference, which he attended something similar last year, he stated. And this is a question that I've heard multiple times, not every single time we see the governor, but as I've live streamed these events of his, asking about his political aspirations, specifically national level political aspirations. Very recently, he's been outright asked about a presidential run for in 2024, next year. And every time he says, I am being elected to this office, I will do this term, I will support President Biden if and when he chooses to run. But he has never said definitively, and this is, I think, why reporters keep asking the question, like, no, I am not running for that. He always has some kind of minor deflection to it. So he doesn't close the door, but he doesn't walk through it. So nonetheless, that is that question that came up. The bill itself, what was signed today? So the Patient and Provider Protection Act was effectively an amendment for a House bill, which I do have a link to for anybody that is really interested in reading the verbatim of this act. I've got a link to it in our story on WGNTV.com. If you're not on there right now, again, link in the video description. But it amends House Bill 4664, which was the House bill that effectively legalized abortion and protected it here within the state, despite what the Supreme Court said. And again, the Supreme Court didn't necessarily illegalize it. They just said this is not a constitutional right, thus it is up to the states to decide. So that is why you have such different reactions and different laws happening in each state. So today, this act, or rather amendment to that House bill, provides additional protections for those seeking abortions or, interestingly enough, gender-affirming health care in the state. So they amended that House bill, which didn't really state much about gender-affirming health care, to bring that piece of the health care world into law here in the state of Illinois. I'll give you a couple of the highlights. You can read a lot more about this on our website. As always, a lot of details there. But the big highlight was that it shields Illinoisans from out-of-state action intended to persecute those who provide, receive, or assist in providing reproductive health care. So essentially, the providers within the state cannot be prosecuted, persecuted, fall under another state's law to punish them, or have any kind of retribution for them providing that service that is legal in this state. Establishes a counterclaim for individuals who have a judgment entered against them in another state for reproductive health care or gender-affirming care that is legal in the state of Illinois. So someone lives in Texas, as an example, comes to Illinois to have a procedure, some kind of health care thing done that is illegal in Texas, goes back to Texas, and then what happens then? Does someone within the state of Texas try to pursue legal action against them? So this law is going to give them a counterclaim measure to try and fight that legal action in that state, their home state. Prevents insurers from charging higher out-of-pocket costs when patients are forced to seek out-of-network provider care due to an in-network provider raising moral objections under the Healthcare Right of Conscience Act. So just another protection. And again, this goes on and on as far as the details. And we have the nice summation that I was reading off of and the link to the full text on our website for those that really want to dig into it. So that is going to do it for this live stream at the moment. I don't have another one planned for WGN News Now. But as always, when news breaks, I am ready to roll with our live streams here on WGN News Now. So until that next live stream, I'm Chip Brewster. Your latest headlines always at WGNTV.com.